Welcome students to Civil Services Achievers Point. Today we are discussing the ancient history and medieval history part 1. So this is the second lecture of our history of Assam classes. So I hope you have gone through the first class, because it is advised to go through the first class first, because many topics in this class are carried forward from the first class. So students, let us begin. At Civil Services Achievers Point, we have regular offline classes, online live classes, and various free initiatives. Also, we have mock interview programs. We are coming up with optional class, ethics class, and CSAT class. This class of History of Assam is primarily based on the new pattern of APSC. However, it will also be useful for the other state level government examinations. The Assam history can be divided into 5 segments: prehistoric period, which is prior to 4th century AD, ancient history, which is from 4th century to 12th century AD, medieval history, from 12th to 19th century AD, modern Indian history, modern Assam history, that is from early 19th century, that is the Treaty of Yandabu, 1826 to 1947, and post-independence Assam history, that is after independence. So we have already covered the prehistoric period of Assam, that is the period of time prior to 4th century AD. So students are advised to kindly go through the first video so as to understand this video very properly. So in this video, we will completely cover the ancient history from 4th century to 12th century AD. Also, we will cover the first half or part 1 of medieval history. So students, let us begin. The first topic we are discussing here is the ancient period, which is from 4th century to 12th century AD. The ancient history of Assam begins with the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa. So the history of Assam is said to begin with the history of Kamrupa. At one point of time, the kingdom of Kamrupa stretched from the hills, the foothills of Himalayas, to the ocean shores of modern day Bangladesh, from northern Bihar till the border of Myanmar. So such was the extent of the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa, which we will understand in our subsequent slides. Some of the major dynasties of Kamrupa are Varman dynasty, Salastamba dynasty, which is also called Mlesa dynasty, and Pala dynasty. However, this Pala dynasty of Kamrupa is not to be confused with the Pala dynasty of Bengal. So we will study each dynasty and their important rulers and their geographical locations in our subsequent slides. Kamrupa, let us know first a brief about Kamrupa. Kamrupa, also called Pragjyotisha or Pragjyotisha Kamrupa, an early state during the classical period or the ancient period on the Indian subcontinent, was the first historical kingdom of Assam. Now, here in the bracket, we have mentioned along with Dobokha. Now, many scholars believe that along with Kamrupa, there was another ancient kingdom called Dobokha, which is present near modern day Nogao. Though Kamrupa existed from 350 AD to 1140 AD, Dobokha was absorbed by Kamrupa in the 5th century AD. That is common era. So this AD is also represented by CE or common era. So students, please do not get confused. So here it is mentioned that ancient Kamrupa was existing between 350 CE to 1140 CE. However, the Dobokha kingdom was absorbed or assimilated by the Kamrupa kingdom by the 5th century CE. We will study this aspect in our subsequent slide. Ruled by 3 dynasties from their capitals in present-day Guwahati, North Guwahati and Tezpur. So Kamrupa had, the kingdom of Kamrupa had different dynasties, and each dynasty had their own capitals. So the capitals were present day Guwahati, North Guwahati and Tezpur. Kamrupa at its height covered the entire Brahmaputra plain. The entire Brahmaputra plain was covered, North Bengal, Bhutan and northern part of Bangladesh, and at times of what is now known as West Bengal and Bihar. So students, here we can see that a very large part of modern day India, Bangladesh, Bhutan, to some extent Myanmar, was also under the kingdom of Kamrupa. Though the historical kingdom disappeared by the 12th century, the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa disappeared by the 12th century after the fall of the Palas, and it was replaced by smaller political entities, which we will study in our which we will study forward. The notion of Kamrupa persisted, and ancient and medieval chroniclers continued to call this region by this name. So here, students, one thing we have to understand, that though by the 12th century AD the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa was replaced or it collapsed, but still in the notion of Kamrupa, the notion of Kamrupa still persisted, and it still persists today. Though there is a Kamrupa district in the modern state of Assam, but do not be confused by the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa and modern district of Kamrup Metro and Kamrup Rural in Assam. So the notion of Kamrupa persisted, and the ancient and medieval chroniclers are the persons who write the Buronjis or the chronicles of various kings and their rules. So those persons are called chroniclers. So the notion of Kamrupa continued to remain, and the chroniclers continue to call this region by this name. In the 6th century, the Ahom kingdom came into prominence and assumed for itself the political and territorial legacy of the Kamrupa kingdom. In our last class, we have already discussed that many kingdom in ancient Assam or in the kingdom of Kamrupa, they tried to establish their lineage from Naroko King Naroko in the prehistory period of Assam. So likewise, after the fall of the Kamrupa kingdom, only the Ahom kingdom could match into the political and the territorial legacy of Kamrupa kingdom, because many kingdoms were established after the Kamrupa kingdom in the medieval period of Assam, but by the political strength and geographical and territorial extent, only Ahom kingdom could match itself with the ancient Kamrupa kingdom. We will study in depth the various dynasties of Kamrupa kingdom. We will also study the various dynasties which ruled Assam in the medieval period also. So students, let us begin to study the various dynasties which ruled the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa. Now, the earliest mention of a kingdom comes from the 4th century Allahabad inscription of Samudragupta that calls the kings of Kamrupa and Dobaka frontier rulers, that is Pratyatna Nipati. So we know Nipati means king and Pratyatna means frontier. So frontier rulers. So from the 4th century Allahabad inscription of Samudragupta, the earliest mention of a kingdom in ancient Kamrupa finds mention. The Chinese traveler Huan Zhang visited the kingdom in the 7th century during the rule of Kumar Bhaskar Varmana, then ruled by Bhaskar Varmana. The corpus of Kamrupa inscriptions left by the rulers of Kamrupa, including Bhaskar Varman, at various places in Assam and present-day Bangladesh, are important sources of information. That means, apart from the Allahabad inscription of Samudragupta, the Chinese traveler Wen Sheng visited the Kamrupa kingdom in the 7th century, which was ruled then by Bhaskar Varman. The corpus of Kamrupa inscriptions, the various inscriptions of Kamrupa left by the rulers of Kamrupa, including Kumar Bhaskar Varman, at various places in Assam and present-day Bangladesh, are important sources of information. As it is a period of ancient history, so there are minimum sources of information available, but the most important are the various corpus of Kamrupa inscriptions left by the rulers of Kamrupa. So we will study some of the important inscriptions left by the Kamrupa kingdom in Assam, and also those some of the inscriptions are present there in Bangladesh, because at one point of time those areas were under the kingdom of Kamrupa. Nevertheless, local grants completely eschewed the name Kamrupa. Instead, they used the name Pragjyotisha, with the king's call Pragjyotishadhipati, means Pragjyotishadhipati. See, though Kamrupa, the kingdom was known as the kingdom of Kamrupa, however, at many of the inscriptions, the name they used was Pragjyotisha, and the kings were called Pragjyotishadhipati. According to the 10th century Kalika Purana and the 7th century Huan Sheng, the western boundary was the historical Karatoya River. So the Karatoya River, which is now in Bangladesh, is the western boundary. The eastern border was the temple of the goddess Tamreshwari, that is Purvate Kamrupaswa Devi Dikkaravasini, that is given in the Kalika Purana. So this is a name of a goddess which is mentioned in the Kalika Purana, and this temple was near the present day Sadia. So we can see the entire Brahmaputra plain was covered in the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa. The southern boundary was near the border between Dhaka and Moymansingh districts in present day Bangladesh. So the southern boundary was near Dhaka and Moymansingh districts in Bangladesh. Thus, the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa spanned the entire Brahmaputra Valley and northeast India, and at various times included parts of present-day Bhutan, Bangladesh, and even Nepal. So, as we can see, the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa spanned the entire Brahmaputra Valley, northeast India, and at times parts of present-day Bhutan, Bangladesh, and even Nepal. The kingdom appears to have broken up entirely by the 13th century into smaller kingdoms, and from them rose the Kamata kingdom in the west, and the Ahom, Dimasa, and the Chutia kingdoms as the main successors, with the Baro Bhuyans ruling intervening areas. So by the 12th and 13th century, the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa broke up into smaller kingdoms, and from among them rose the Kamata kingdom in the west, which further led to the rise of the Koch dynasty. So Kamata kingdom and subsequently the Koch dynasty in the west, the Ahom, Dimasa, and Chutia kingdoms in the east, and in the middle portion there was the Baro Bhuyas ruling. So we will study each of these kingdoms in details in our subsequent classes. Now coming to another important kingdom, which was in parallel with the Kamrupa kingdom, was the Dabhoka kingdom. The Dabhoka was a kingdom of ancient Indian subcontinent located in current central region of Assam state. The references to it comes from the 4th century Allahabad pillar inscription of Samudragupta, where it is mentioned as one of 5 frontier kingdoms of the Gupta Empire. So the earliest reference to the Dabhoka kingdom comes from the 4th century Allahabad pillar inscription of Samudragupta, where it is mentioned as one of 5 frontier kingdoms of the Gupta Empire. The Shung Shu history of the Liu Song dynasty, where the kingdom is named Kapili, So the, as we know, the Kapili River is now in near Nogaon district. So the Doboka kingdom was based near the modern day Nogaon district of Assam. So along with the 4th century Allahabad pillar inscription, mention is also found in the Song Shu history of the Liu Song dynasty of China, where the kingdom of Doboka is called Kopili. The Khatstal stone pillar inscription written in Kamrupi Prakrit. So these are some of the early known references to the kingdom of Doboka. N.K. Bhattasali, an eminent historian, N.K. Bhattasali, an eminent historian, has identified it with the Doboka in modern-day Nogaon district, with the kingdom associated with the Kopili Kolong River Valley. So another river valley existed in ancient Assam was the Kopili Kolong River Valley, and the kingdom based near the Kopili Kolong River Valley was the Doboka kingdom in modern-day Nogaon district. In 4th century Doboka, Doboka was mentioned as frontier kingdom with Kamrupa in the Samudragupta's Prayag stone inscription, which was later absorbed by 6th or 7th century by the Western kingdom of Kamrupa. So in the 4th century, in the Samudragupta's Prayag stone inscription, Doboka was mentioned as frontier kingdom along with Kamrupa. So Kamrupa and Doboka both were mentioned in the 4th century. However, after 6th or 7th century, it was no longer mentioned, because it is estimated that by then the ancient kingdom of Doboka was absorbed by the kingdom of Kamrupa. Though later historians like B.N. Puri and P.C. Choudhury claim that it was absorbed much earlier in the first half of the 5th century itself, during the reign of Kalyana Varman, an important ruler of the Varman dynasty of the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa. Its capital, the capital of Doboka, was located near Kopili River. In the year 428 AD, an embassy was sent to China by Doboka king, whose name, according to China's sources, is Yusei or Yugnei. So thus, along with the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa, there existed an ancient kingdom of Doboka in the modern district of Nogaon in Assam, in the Kopili Kolong River Valley. So here you can see, students, a map of Kamrupa kingdom at its height. You can see the entire Brahmaputra plain, some parts of northeastern states, parts of Bhutan, parts of Bangladesh, and modern day West Bengal also. Here you can see some, along with some other ancient kingdoms, the kingdom of Kamrupa. Now this is important. Rulers of Varman dynasty. The Varman dynasty was established by Pushya Varman. So students, please make a note of this table, because APSC may ask in preliminary examination the founder of Varman dynasty, and also it may ask the last ruler of Varman dynasty. So the important, some of the important rulers of Varman dynasty are Pushya Varman, Samudra Varman, Mahendra Varman, Mahabhuti Varman, and Bhaskar Varman. We will study about them in details in our coming slides. Varman dynasty. Now the Varman dynasty is between 355 to 650 AD. The Varman dynasty was the first historical dynasty of the Kamrupa kingdom. So this is an important point. Students, please note them, that the Varman dynasty was the first historical dynasty of the Kamrupa kingdom. It was established by Pushya Varman, a contemporary of Samudragupta, of the Gupta Empire. The kingdom, which he established with much effort, grew in the periphery of the Gupta Empire, adopted the North Indian political model, and its kings took on names and titles of the Gupta kings and queens. So here, students, you can see that the Varman dynasty was established by Pushyavarman, a contemporary of Samudragupta. The kingdom which Pushyavarman established with much effort grew in the periphery of the Gupta Empire, adopted the North Indian political model, and the kings of the Varman dynasty took on names and titles of the Gupta kings and queens. As you can see, the various names are similar to the Gupta kingdom, like Samudra Varman here, Mahendra Varman, Narayan Varman. So these are names similar to the names of the kings of the Gupta Empire. The earlier Varmans were subordinates of the Gupta Empire, but as the power of the Guptas waned or decreased, Mahendra Varman performed two horse sacrifices, that is the Ashwamedh Yagya, and status of Kamrupa as independent state remained unimpaired. So this is a symbol, copper plate seal of Kamrupa kings. According to Allahabad Prashasti of Samudragupta, the ruler of Kamrupa was mentioned as a frontier ruler, Pratyatna Nipatis, of the great Gupta emperor. So as per the Allahabad Prashasti of Samudragupta, the rulers of Kamrupa were mentioned as Pratyatna Nipatis, meaning frontier ruler of the great Gupta emperor. As per Apsat inscription of Aditya Sen, Sushti Varman was defeated by Mahendra Sen Gupta on the bank of Lohita. Now this bank of Lohita may be referring to the river Brahmaputra. The capital was Pragjyotishpura, and the capital of the Varman dynasty was Pragjyotishpura and located at the southeastern slope of the Narakasur hill near Dispur. So many students will know that there is a hill in Guwahati in Assam near Dispur which is called Narakasur hill, and many historians believe that the Narakasur hill was the home to the king Naraka, and subsequently many kings in ancient Assam or ancient period of Kamrupa decided to establish their kingdom near that so as to they can claim their lineage to that king. The dynastic line from Pushyavarman first appeared in the 7th century in Dubi and Nidhanpur copper plate inscriptions issued by Bhaskar Varman, and in the Harsha Sarita, though the descriptions are panegyric, repetitive and devoid of dates. That is, the dynastic line from the first king of Varman dynasty, Pushyavarman, appeared in the 7th century in the Dubi and Nidhanpur copper plate inscriptions issued by Bhaskar Varman and in the Harsha Sarita. However, the descriptions are repetitive and are devoid of any proper dates. Though some modern scholars have opined that the Varman dynasty is probably of Indo-Aryan descent, it is now believed that the Varmans were originally non-Indo-Aryans. So there is a debate regarding the descent of the Varman kings. Suniti Kumar Chatterjee calls Bhaskar Varman a Hinduist Mlesha king of Indo-Mongoloid origin. Hughes B. Urban too infers that Varmans descended from non-Aryan tribes. So many historians have inferred that the Varmans descended from the non-Aryan tribes. Now we will study the important rulers of the Varman dynasty. The most important ruler of Varman dynasty is Pushyavarman, between 350 to 380 AD. Pushyavarman, he is the founder of Varman dynasty, contemporary of great Gupta ruler Samudragupta. He took the title Maharajadhiraja. He ensured steps to establish Kamrupa as a frontier state. So, Pushyavarman is the founder of Varman dynasty. Pushyavarman was the contemporary of great Gupta ruler Samudragupta. He took the title Maharajadhiraja. He also ensured steps to establish Kamrupa as a frontier state. The next important ruler is Samudra Varman. Samudra Varman ruled between 380 to to 405 AD. He is the son of Pushyavarman, contemporary of great Gupta ruler Chandragupta II, who is also popularly known as Vikramaditya. The next important ruler is Mahendra Varman. He ruled between 450 to 485 AD. Mahendra Varman was the first Varman dynasty king to conduct the Ashwamedh ritual. The first king of Kamrupa who waged a successful war against Gupta army. He possibly liberated Varman dynasty from the Gupta dominance. So he was the first Varman dynasty king to conduct the Ashwamedh ritual, and he also liberated Varman dynasty from Gupta dominance. The next important ruler is Mahabhuti Varman. He ruled from 510 to 555 AD. During the reign of Mahabhuti Varman, a big portion of North Bengal and Bihar was included within the kingdom of Kamrupa. Mahabhuti Varman came to be known as Parama Bhagavata, which shows an inclination towards Vaishnavism. After Mahabhuti Varman, certain later Varman rulers showed weakness and consequently were defeated by later Guptas. As a result, the kingdom of Kamrupa contracted in the west and the river Karatoya became the boundary. So after Mahabhuti Varman, the subsequent rulers of the Varman dynasty showed weakness, were weak, and hence they were defeated by the later Guptas. So the kingdom of Kamrupa contracted or became smaller in size and in the western side, and the river Karatoya became the boundary. Kumar Bhaskar Varman was the last and greatest king of the Varman dynasty and a contemporary of Harshavardhana. Harshavardhan honored Kumar Bhaskar Varman at a conference held at Kannauj. During the reign of Bhaskar Varman, Kamrupa became a dominant power in all India politics. He, jointly with Harshavardhan of Kannauj, defeated ruler of Bengal called Sasanka and forced him to flee to Odisha. Chinese traveler Huan Zhang lived in the court of Bhaskar Varman for some time. Assamese calendar Bhaskarabda. The Assamese calendar Bhaskarabda is counted from the date of the accession of the Kumar Bhaskar Varman to the throne of Kamrupa. Now this is a very, very important point. Students should know this, that the Bhaskarabda or the Assamese calendar is counted from the date of the accession of Kumar Bhaskar Varman to the throne of Kamrupa. The achievements of Kumar Bhaskar Varman are mentioned in Banabhatta's Harsha Charita, Huan Zhang's Siyuki, and various inscriptions found. So these books are important and the authors are important. Students, please make a note of it, that the achievements of Bhaskar Varman are mentioned in Harsha Charita, which is written by Banabhatta, Siyuki, which is written by Huan Zhang, and the various inscriptions found in Assam and other parts of Northeast India. Kumar Bhaskar Varman was a bachelor king. That is why he was known as Kumar Bhaskar Varman. The dynastic line from Pushya Varman first appeared in the 7th century in the Dubi and Nidhanpur copper inscriptions issued by Bhaskar Varman and in the Harsharita. Now, let us discuss the Dubi copper plate inscription. The Dubi copper plate inscription are the inscriptions of a grant issued by Bhaskar Varman of Kamrupa. This is the earliest of all the copper plate grants issued by Kamrupa kings discovered so far. This was an issue after an earlier charter issued by Mahabhuti Varman, which was destroyed. So the Dubi copper plate inscription was issued after an earlier charter which was issued by Mahabhuti Varman was destroyed. All six plates in this grant were first discovered around 1950 during digging near a Shiva temple in Dubi village. So the Dubi copper plate inscription, Dubi is a village about 3 miles from the Patsala railway station, Kamrup district. So at that time, the Patsala was in the Kamrupa district. These plates are currently in the Assam State Museum. This plate was issued before the Nidhanpur copper inscription during the earlier part of the Bhaskar Varman's reign. The Nidhanpur copper plate inscription of the 7th century Kamrupa king Bhaskar Varman gives a detailed account of land grants given to Brahmins. The copper plates were discovered on 29 December 1912 in the village of Nidhanpur in Panchaganda near what is now Silhet in Bangladesh. So as we have already discussed, the geographical extent of the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa lies in some parts of modern day Bangladesh also, as it is evident from the fact that the Nidhanpur copper plate inscription was found in a village called Nidhanpur in Panchakhanda in Silhet in the Bangladesh. The copper plates were found mostly in Panchakhanda Pargana, where historians opine that actual granted lands are located. The inscriptions recorded by Bhaskar Varman in different parts of India provide a detailed account of his rule and associate events. It was customary among the kings of Kamrupa to issue seals for every major event related to the kingdom, be they giving land grants to Brahmins or winning a war. So it was a customary among the kings of Kamrupa to issue seals for every major event like land grants to Brahmin or winning a war. Now another important personality or traveler who visited India and Assam in ancient times was Wen Chang. Wen Chang, Chinese traveler Wen Chang, came to India around 630 AD, around 643 AD, during the Kumar Bhaskar Varman reign. Wen Chang visited Kamrupa and remained in his court for some time. He compiled his accounts in his book, Si Yu Ki. The account of Wen Chang provides various insights on the socio-economic and geographical features of the kingdom of Kamrupa. In his account, he mentions about the language spoken being different from North India. People worshipped to devas and performed sacrifices, and the Hindus were divided into many sects. There was a minimum following of Buddhism at that period. So these were the observations of Wen Chang when he visited the kingdom of Kamrupa. Now another important dynasty after Kamrupa was the Salastamba dynasty or the Mlesa dynasty. The Salastamba dynasty was the next in line, which began with the reign of chieftain called Salastamba. So the Salastamba dynasty is under the name of the first ruler Salastamba. The Salastamba dynasty is also called Mlesa dynasty. The Mlesa dynasty ruled Kamrupa from their capital at Harupeshwar or Da Parbatia in the present day Tezpur, Assam. The capital of the Mlesa dynasty, which ruled Kamrupa from their capital at Harupeshwar or Da Parbatia. So at that time, the present day Tezpur was also under the kingdom of Kamrupa. According to the historical records, there were 21 rulers in this dynasty, but the line is obscure and the names of some intervening rulers are not known. Mlesa may be a Sanskritized form of tribal name Mes. Suniti Kumar Chatterjee, a known historian, claims that Salastamba was a Boro Kosari chief of Mles. According to some historians, the remnant of the Mlesa kingdom formed the later Kosari kingdom. So we will study in details the Kosari kingdom in our subsequent classes. Now this is a list of important rulers of the Mlesa kingdom or Salastamba kingdom. The kingdom was started by Salastamba, and some of the important rulers were discussed in the next slides. Among all the kings of Salastamba, it was Sri Harshadeva who equated himself as a good king. His kingdom extended up to Gaur, which is a which is North Bengal, Orissa, Kalinga, and Kushal, that is North Bihar. Another great king of this dynasty was Harjara Varman. He was the first in this dynasty to get the throne in Vedic rituals. He established the capital at Harupeshwar, Tezpur. According to some historians, the remnant of the lesser kingdom formed the later Kasari kingdom. Now, another dynasty after the Salastamba dynasty was the Pala dynasty. Now, this Pala dynasty is not to be confused with the Pala dynasty of the Bengal. The Pala dynasty of Bengal were Buddhist. However, the Pala dynasty of Kamrupa were Hindus. Brahmapala was the founder of Pala dynasty. Now, this is a very important point because APSC has asked in the prelims examination who was the founder of Pala dynasty. The answer is Brahmapala. So the founder of Pala dynasty was Brahmapala. Ratnapala, the son of Brahmapala, was the most famous king of this dynasty. Jayapala was the last ruler of this dynasty. Some of the important rulers of Pala dynasty are mentioned in this table. Students, please make a note of the founder and the last king of this dynasty. Now, some of the important rulers are Ratnapal, most famous king and great administrator. He shifted the capital to Guwahati and named it Sri Durjoya. He took the title of Maharajadhiraja, similar to Varman, and thus tried to establish legitimacy. Dharmapal, he may have shifted the capital to North Guwahati. The Pala dynasty came to an end when Kamrupa was invaded by the Gaur king of Bengal, Ramapala. Timga Deva was made the governor of Kamrupa, who ruled between 1110 and 1126 AD. Timga Deva threw off the yoke of the Pala king and ruled independently for some years when he was attacked and replaced by Baidyadeva under Rampala's son Kumarapala. Baidyadeva who ruled between 1126 and 1140 AD, declared independence within 4 years of his rule after the death of Kumarapala. Both Timgadeva and Baidyadeva issued grants in the style of Kamrupa kings, 3 copper plates attached to the seal of Kamrupa kings by ring. The work of the Pala dynasty of Kamrupa is reflected in the Madan Kamdeva sculpture. As we know, the Madan Kamdeva sculpture near Guwahati, these sculptures reflects the works of the Pala dynasty of the Kamrupa. Kamrupa kings after Palas. Now, after the Pala dynasty ended, kings such as Bhingadeva, Baidyadeva, Rairideva, Udaykarna, and Palladeva and Prithu rule over Kamrupa. So after the collapse of the Kamrupa kingdom, the Mohammedans first attacked kingdom of Kamrupa, and during the attack or the period of attack may be called the beginning of the medieval era of Assam. During the reign of Prithu in 1206 and 1226, Bengal Sultanate Muhammad ibn Bakhtiar invaded Kamrupa. In 1228, Delhi Sultanate Iltutmish killed Prithu. With the collapse of Pala dynasty, with the collapse of Pala dynasty of Kamrupa, ancient history of Assam ends here. Now, various kings ruling different parts of Kamrupa after the collapse of the Palas are given in this table. Some of the important kings ruling different parts of Kamrupa after the collapse of Palas are Baidyadeva, Prithu, Sandhya, Dulabanarayan, Arimatta, or Sasanka. So with this, we are ending the ancient history of Assam. So students, please keep revising this part, because a question from ancient history of Assam is sure shot in both in the preliminary and mains of APSC. So now we are beginning, as we have as we have completed with the prehistory and the history period of Assam, prehistory and ancient history of Assam, now we are beginning with the medieval part. The medieval history of Assam was between 12th century to early 19th century of Assam. The important events and kingdoms of medieval history of Assam were first Mohammedan invasion of Kamrupa, Kingdom of Kamota, Chutia Kingdom, Baro Bhuyas, Kos Kingdom, Kasare Kingdom, Zandia Kingdom, Ahom Kingdom, Burmese War, and the East India Company. So by 1826, that is the Treaty of Yandabu, the medieval history of Assam ends and the modern Assam history begins. The first Mohammedan invasion, 1206 and 1226 of Kamrupa, took place during the reign of a king called Pithu, who was killed in a battle with Iltutmish in 1228. During the second invasion by Ikhtiyaruddin Yuzbek or Tughril Khan about 1257, the king of Kamrupa, Sandhya, transferred the capital Kamrup Nagar to Kamatapur in the west. So this led to the establishment of the medieval kingdom of Kamatapur. From then onwards, Kamata's ruler were called Kamateswar. According to traditions, Lower Assam and the adjacent part of Bengal subsequently formed a kingdom called Kamata, and its ruler at the beginning of the 14th century was Dulab Narayan. He is followed by Indra Narayan, and probably he was the last ruler of this dynasty, because after that the Koch dynasty begins. During the last part of the 14th dynasty, Arimatta was the ruler of Gaur, the northern region of former Kamatapur, who had his capital at Vaidyanagar. The last descendant of Arimatta was Mriganka, who died childless, followed by the rule of the Bhuyas. And after the invasion of the Mughals in the 5th century, many Muslims settled in this state and can be said to be the first Muslim settlers of this region. In the 5th century, a line of Khen kings rose to power, and Nilambar, the third and the last of this line, was overthrown in 1498 by Hussein Shah, who after a long siege took the capital Kamatapur by his stratagem. So this is a brief rough idea of the medieval history of Assam. We will go in details in the next slides. Now the first topic in medieval Assam is the first Mohammedan invasion of Kamrupa. In 1206, the Afghan Muhammad-e-Bakhtiar or Bakhtiar Khilji passed through the Kamrupa against Tibet, which ended in disaster, the first of many Turko-Afghan invasions. The ruler of Kamrupa at this point was Prithu, who was also called Britu in Tabakat-e-Nasiri, who is sometimes identified with Vishwasundara, the son of Vallabh Deva of the Lunar dynasty, mentioned in the Khatstal inscription of 1232 AD. Prithu withstood invasions from Ghiyasuddin Iwaz Shah of Gora, who retreated but was killed in the subsequent invasion by Nasiruddin Mahmud in 1228. Nasiruddin installed a tributary king, but after his death in 1229, the control of Kamrupa lapsed back to local rulers. So there was a frequent transfer of power in the post collapse of Pala dynasty when the Mohammedan invaded Kamrupa for the first time. Now the kingdom of Kamata, from the local rulers there emerged a strong ruler called Sandhya, the Rai of Kamrup, with his capital at Kamrup Nagar, the seat of the last Pala kings. So after the Pala dynasty collapsed, the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa was carried forwarded by the kingdom of Kamata to some extent. So a strong ruler named Sandhya, the Rai of Kamrup, shifted his capital from Kamrupa Nagar to Kamutapur. Malik Ikhtiaruddin Uzbek, a governor of Gor for the Mamluk rulers of Delhi, attempted an invasive attack on Sandhya's domain in 1257. And Sandhya, with the help of the spring floods that same year, captured and killed the Sultan. Subsequent to this attack, Sandhya moved his capital from Kamrupa Nagara to Kamutapur. So Kamutapur was the capital of Kingdom of Kamata and established a new kingdom that came to be called as Kamata Kingdom. At that time after the collapse of the Pala dynasty, the first Mohammedan attack happened and the Kingdom of Kamata was established. And at that time, the Western Kamrupa was the domain of the Kochs and Mess peoples. In the western part of Kamrupa, the Kingdom of Kamata was established, and that part was the domain of the Kochs and Mess peoples. In other parts of the erstwhile Kamrupa, so the Kamrupa Kingdom led to the Kamata Kingdom in the west, the Kasare Kingdom in central and south Assam, Baro Buyas in central and north bank, and the Sutia Kingdom in the east. So this is a very, very important point, that after the Pala dynasty, the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa led to the Kingdom of Kamata in the west, Kasare Kingdom in the central and south, Baro Buyas in the central and north, and the Sutia Kingdom in the east. The Ahoms, who would establish a strong and independent kingdom later on, began building their state structures in the region between Kasari and Sutia in 1228. So we will study each of these medieval kingdoms in details in our subsequent slides and in our subsequent kingdom subsequent classes. Sutia Kingdom, one of the most important kingdom and one of the most early kingdom of the medieval history of Assam, is the Sutia Kingdom. During the earlier part of the 13th century, when the Ahoms established their rule over Assam with the capital at Sivasagar, the Subansiri area and by the banks of the Disang River were under the control of the Sutias. According to popular Sutia legend, Sutia King Birpal established his rule at Sadia in 1189. So this is another a very important point, that who was the founder of Sutia Kingdom? Sutia King Birpal was the founder of the Sutia Kingdom in 1189. Birpal was succeeded by 10 kings, of whom the 8th king, Dhir Narayan or Dharmaraj, had a son, Sadak Narayan, and a daughter, Sadani. In his old age, he handed over his kingdom to his son-in-law Nitai or Nityapal. So Nityapal is the last ruler of the Sutia Kingdom. Later on, Nityapal's incompetent rule gave an opportunity to the Ahom king Suhungmung Dhinga Raja, who annexed it to the Ahom kingdom. Sadhani and Nityapal committed suicide after the Sutia Kingdom was annexed by the Ahoms. So as you can see, this figure represents the Sutia Kingdom approximately 13th century during the reign of King Gauri Narayan. The Sutia Kingdom occupied parts of the Upper Assam in the north bank of Brahmaputra and major parts of modern day Arunachal Pradesh. In this figure, we can see some existing weaponry used by the Sutia kings. Baro Buyas. The Buyas were petty chiefs who had their petty principalities towards the east of Kamrup and Kamata area. So towards the east of Kamrup and Kamata and towards the west of Sutia Kingdom, there was a principalities area called the Buyas, and it was towards the east of the Kamrup Kamata area. The Baro Buyas were politically aware, and accordingly they made the adjustments, sometimes accepting the suzerainty of kings more powerful then them, or sometimes declaring their independence. The Barobhuyas were politically very aware, and accordingly they made adjustments. That means sometimes they accepted the sovereignty or a powerful kingdom's rule, and also sometimes they declared their independence. The title Baro is a title of honor given to 12 chieftains. That is 12. Agharo, Baro, Tero. So Baro is the number given to 12 chieftains who, even though were not kings, established in their independence, they stood united against any common enemy. So these chieftains were not kings. However, they established their independence and they stood united against any common enemy. They took up arms against the Ahoms also, but it was the Ahom king Pratap Singh who crushed the rebellion of the Barobhuyas. So the rebellion of the Barobhuyas was crushed by the Ahom king Pratap Singh. Mention here should also be made of Srimant Mahapurukh Srimant Hangardev, the most illustrious of the Barobhuyans. So with this, friends, we have come to end of today's class. In the next class, we will discuss some of the important dynasties and kingdoms of the medieval history of Assam. Some of them are Koch Kingdom, Kasare Kingdom, Jayantia Kingdom, Ahom Kingdom, the Burmese attacks and the collapse of the Ahom kingdoms, and finally the East India Company. So the medieval history of Assam, the medieval history of Assam begins with the Mohammedan attacks at the ancient kingdom of Kamrupa and the establishment of Kamata kingdom in the west and establishment of Sutia kingdom in the east. So these events marks the beginning of medieval history of Assam, and the attacks of the Burmese invasions and the coming of East India Company to Assam with the Treaty of Yandavu in 1826, these events marks the end of the medieval history of Assam and thereby the beginning of the modern history of Assam. So students, I hope this class was very helpful. We have discussed many points in details. So please study these points regularly and revise them so that if any question comes in both prelims and mains, they can be answered correctly. At Civil Services Achievers Point, we have various offline regular classes, online live classes, various free initiatives. We have mock interview programs. Also, we are coming up with optional classes, ethics classes and CSET classes. Students, please join this program so as to ensure a sure shot rank in the upcoming civil service examinations. So with this, we are ending this class. Thank you.